Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Martin,
bishop in the Church of God, on behalf of the clergy and people of the Diocese of West Missouri,
we present to you Mark William Jeske to be received as a presbyter in this branch of Christ's Holy Catholic Church.
We present to you James Elbert Lile, Jr. to be ordained deacon in Christ's Holy Catholic Church.
We present to you Brock Allen Slabach to be ordained deacon in Christ's Holy Catholic Church.
Have they been selected in accordance with the canons of this church? And do you believe their manner of life to be suitable to the exercise of this ministry?
We certify to you that they have satisfied the requirements of the canons, and we believe them qualified for this order.
You have been presented. Will you be loyal to the doctrine, discipline, and worship of Christ as this church has received them? And will you, in accordance with the canons of this church, obey your bishop and other ministers who may have authority over you and your work?
I am willing and ready to do so, and I solemnly declare that I do believe the Holy Scriptures of the Old and the New Testaments to be the Word of God, and to contain all things necessary to salvation. And I do solemnly engage to conform to the doctrine, discipline, and worship of the Episcopal Church.
Let the declarations be signed. As you are able, I invite you to stand. Dear friends in Christ, you know the importance of this ministry and the weight of your responsibility in presenting Mark William Jeske to be received as a priest in this church, and in presenting James Elbert Lile, Jr. and Brock Allen Slabach for ordination to the Sacred Order of Deacons. Therefore, if any of you know any impediment or crime because of which we should not proceed, come forward now and make it known. Is it your will that Mark be received as a priest and that Jim and Brock be ordained deacons?
It is.
Will you uphold them in this ministry?
We will.
Let us in peace pray to the Lord.
God the Father,
have mercy on us.
God the Son,
have mercy on us.
God the Holy Spirit,
have mercy on us.
Holy Trinity, one God,
have mercy on us.
We pray to you, Lord Christ.
Lord, hear our prayer.
it may be filled with truth and love, and be found without fault at the day of your coming. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For all members of your church in their vocation and ministry, that they may serve you in a true and godly life, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, for Martin, our bishop, for Metla of Botswana, and for all bishops, priests, and deacons, that they may be filled with your love, may hunger for truth, and may thirst after righteousness, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For Mark, to be received as a priest in your church, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For James and Brock, chosen deacons in your church, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
That they may faithfully fulfill the duties of this ministry, build up your church, and glorify your name. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That by the indwelling of thy Holy Spirit, they may be sustained and encouraged to persevere to the end. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For their families, that they may be adorned with all Christian virtues, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For all who fear God and believe in you, Lord Christ, that our divisions may cease, and that all may be one as you and the Father are one, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For the mission of the church, that in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For those who do not yet believe, and for those who have lost their faith, that they may receive the light of the gospel, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For the peace of the world, that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and peoples, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For those in positions of public trust, that they may serve justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For a blessing upon all human labor, and for the right use of the riches of creation, that the world may be freed from poverty, famine, and disaster, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer, for refugees, prisoners, and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For ourselves, for the forgiveness of our sins, and for the grace of the Holy Spirit to amend our lives, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died in the communion of the church, and those whose faith is known to you alone, that with all the saints they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but life eternal, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Rejoicing in the fellowship of all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God.
To you, O Lord our God.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God of unchangeable power and eternal light, look favorably on your whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery. By the effectual working of your providence, Carry out in tranquility the plan of salvation. Let the whole world see and know that things which were cast down are being raised up, and things which had grown old are being made new, and that all things are being brought to their perfection by him through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Our first lesson is from Isaiah chapter 55. Thus says the Lord, Ho, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, and you that have no money, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me, and eat what is good, and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Listen, so that you may live. I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. See, I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander for the peoples. See, you shall call nations that you do not know, and nations that do not know you shall run to you, because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their way and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them return to the Lord that he may have mercy on them, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return there until they have watered the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose and succeed in the thing for which I sent it. For you shall go out in joy and be led back in peace. The mountains and the hills before you burst into song, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress. Instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle. And it shall be to the Lord for a memorial, for an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Oh, the second letter of Paul to the Corinthians. Since it is by God's mercies that we are engaged in this ministry, we do not lose heart. We have renounced the shameful things that one hides. We refuse to practice cunning or to falsify God's word. But by the open statement of the truth, we commend ourselves to the conscience of everyone in the sight of God. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For we do not proclaim ourselves. We proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your slaves for Jesus' sake. For it is the God who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," who has shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
To return from the wedding banquet, so that they may open the door for him as soon as he comes and knocks. Blessed are those slaves whom the master finds alert when he comes. Truly I tell you, he will fasten his belt and have them sit down to eat, and he will come and serve them. If he comes during the middle of the night or near dawn and finds them so, blessed are those slaves. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord Christ.
speak to you in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated. Years ago, far more years than I care to count, I was a senior in high school. I lived in Ohio, and for my sophomore, junior, and senior years, I had become very active in the youth ministry of my local and regional church. I was, at that time, not Episcopalian. Mercifully, God led me to that later. I say I was active as a sophomore, junior, and senior, but I had not been active from grade 4 through about my freshman year. It was only as a sophomore, after I discovered girls, that I was led to join our youth group at our local church, because a girl I was trying to date invited me to attend with her. She was a member of the same church I was faithfully not attending, so I at least knew the way to the church. I walked by it every day on my way to and from school. Being an active youth group member in that congregation meant participating in church camp each summer. So as I got less interested in her and more interested in church, I started attending church camp. Obviously, I didn't marry that. This church camp was a wonderful experience, but it was also a disturbing experience. Because you see, I had an experience. I experienced Jesus in my life. I experienced the Holy Spirit as a real presence and power. I experienced a subtle calling beckoning me to do things that I did not want to do, and to become the person I did not want to become. Truthfully, to say I was disturbed is the same thing as calling an F5 tornado a slight breeze. I was terrified beyond merely disturbed. You see, I liked hanging out with the kids, and that stuff that happened at camp, it was fun. But I didn't buy into all this God and Jesus and Holy Spirit stuff. Intellectually, and at the ripe old age of 17, I was content to be a worldly kind of fellow. I intended to dedicate myself to the family business, to making a financial fortune if I could, and to living as well as I could no matter what. I also assumed I'd eventually have the love of a wonderful woman, maybe a traditional family, and a big house and a luxurious sports car and a dog. Camp, God kept getting too real. And a real God was going to be in the way of my plans. You see, if God was real, I was going to have to take him seriously. I couldn't just blow off the creator of the universe, so I was in for a little bit perplexed. Even though I was at that time a greedy little cuss, I at least had enough integrity to realize that I couldn't blow off God. So at camp, during the summers after my sophomore and junior years, I paid lip service to God, had a great time, failed at impressing the girls, and worked very hard to push back any sense I had that God was real or present or significant. That was until my last year at summer church camp. Summer after my senior year became the culmination of a year-long, well, multi-year-long, wrestling match with God. Kind of like the wrestling match Jacob had with the angel before he got his new name, Israel. Though mine was more internal and even more metaphoric than the one described in the book of Genesis. All during my senior year, as I was trying to choose a college, believe it or not, in those days, you didn't have to go early decision or early admission when you were a sophomore to get into a college. As I was trying to make some sense out of the massive changes that were hurtling toward me like a locomotive bearing down on me, as I was just trying to finish one segment, one season of my life and get ready for what was to come next, God would not quit bugging me. Imagine this. A fly that buzzes your ear nonstop, day in and day out, always too fast to swat, always present, always droning on annoyingly in the back of your mind, in the back of your life. That's what God was to me that year. It was infuriating, maddening, and unwelcome. Of course, I knew what all the buzzing was all about. I refused to admit it to myself, but I knew. God was tapping me on the shoulder in order to call me to his service. I knew that. I refused to know that, but I knew that. I refused to go along. I refused to even enter the conversation. Instead, I wrestled with him internally. You aren't real, I told him. You aren't there. Leave me alone. Go away. A few years later, I came across a book that summed it all up. The title of the book, and I love this title, was Your Arms Are Too Short to Box with God. When I first read that title, I thought, huh, no kidding. I found that to be true later, but during my senior year, I was still trying to go toe-to-toe with God to see if I could win. So there we are, my last year at camp. In the fall, I start college, and what does God do for my last week at camp? He turns up the volume on his buzzing. He turns up the annoying call on my life that I detest. I mean, I didn't even believe in God. That's what I told myself. At our church camp, the last night was consecration night. On that night, a special service of worship and Holy Communion was held that ended with all of us taking a vow of silence through the night. I was so worked up by that time, I couldn't sleep. So I made my way to a large wooden cross that was erected in the middle of a glade of trees. I knelt there. I wasn't sure who I was talking to. I prayed. I'd never really tried that before, other than to stay quiet while other people spoke to God for the crowd I was in. It was all coming to the climactic moment. Kneeling at a cross, I experienced that all my intellectual denial could not obviate what I was experiencing. God is real. And God was reaching into my life. I surrendered. And a white warmth filled me head to toe and fingertip to fingertip. And I knew then and there that I could only be happy if I served God, the completely real and living God who had so annoyed me for a year, but who now I so wanted to know and follow. As you can guess, from that moment, my life was on a bit of a different course. My plans no longer mattered. They were just so much dust in the wind. From that moment on, God's call mattered. So that's what I wanted. And following his call, well, it has me where I am today. I regret it not one bit. Now, I think there's a bit of that story, that experience, in this evening's gospel lesson. And since this sermon has been way too much about me up to this point, let's talk about that for now. In the passage, which has clear apocalyptic overtones about the return of the Messiah and what the Messiah's servant should be doing in the meantime, we encounter the need for readiness. It's funny that an apocalyptic passage like this is one of the options as the gospel lesson for ordinations. But the issue of readiness is before us this day. There are three gentlemen who have worked very hard to get ready for this moment. Maybe they knew that their own experience of that buzzing, annoying God working in the back of their lives. Maybe it came easier to them. I don't know, really. Maybe they had a very real, very recent memory of God calling them to this. They've certainly gone through a lot because they felt called. They feel called. And maybe the best evidence that they have been called is that they stuck with the process of getting ready until they were ready. Because it's not an easy job to do to go through that process. And ready they are. Brock is ready to be a deacon, to offer himself as a servant leader and a leader of his servants who serve a servant Messiah. Jim is ready to experience the life of a deacon so that it may enrich his further ordination to the priesthood with a deep understanding of the diaconal order that serves at the bishop's discretion and most often alongside priests. Mark, who has been so superbly prepared for pastoral ministry among our brothers and sisters of the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, is ready to be integrated fully into the Anglican Episcopal tradition, which, and he's told me his story, feels so much like a fit and a home and his place. Readiness. They are ready. Still, how many of us are as ready as we need to be? Can any of us claim to be ready for whatever the future might bring to the church and to this diocese? Do we know for what we need to get ready? And do we genuinely need to know what's coming? The gospel leads us to believe that we don't have to know the future to be ready. We already know what we need to know. God holds the future. We can trust that God will lead us on. In the meantime, here's how we dress for action, trim our wicks, fuel up our lamps, and stand alert and ready. We continue in the apostles' teaching of breaking bread and in the prayers. We persevere in resisting evil, and whenever we fall into sin, we repent and return to the Lord. We proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ. We seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving our neighbors as ourselves. And we strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being. This latter is our theme for today and tomorrow. Through workshops and lunch and time together, we have recognized and affirmed one another's dignity and learned how, on behalf of Christ, we are and can be about the business of justice and peace. It will not do, however, for us to leave that commitment behind when we leave this convention, or when we leave our churches, or when we leave our homes. The characteristics of the ready servant, lamps fueled and wicks trimmed, are that they are on duty all the time. For them, there is no secular time and sacred time. For them, since time belongs to the one who created it, all our minutes, seconds, hours, days, and years are sacred time. The inbreaking of the holy can happen at any moment. We are called to be ready. We are all called to be ready. To be dressed for action, and to have our lamps lit. You who this day join the ranks of the clergy leaders of the Episcopal Church are called to be ready. And you are called to help the people you lead and serve to be ready. To be on the job, to be able on that day to stand before Christ in his triumph and to greet him, knowing that each has served the Lord with all his heart, and with all her soul, and all his mind, and all her strength. Each of us, all of us, ready all the time. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please be seated. My brother Mark, the ministry we share is none other than the sacrificial ministry of Christ, who gave himself up to death on the cross for the salvation of the world. By his glorious resurrection, he opened for us the way of everlasting life. By the gift of the Holy Spirit, he shares with us the riches of his grace. We are called to proclaim his death and resurrection, to administer the sacraments of the new covenant which he sealed with his blood on the cross, and to care for his people in the power of the Spirit. Do you here, in the presence of Christ and his church, renew your commitment to your ministry under the pastoral direction of your bishop?
I do.
Do you reaffirm your promise to give yourself to prayer and study?
I do.
Do you reaffirm your promise so to minister the word of God and the sacraments of the new covenant that the reconciling love of Christ may be known and received?
I do.
Do you reaffirm your promise to be a faithful servant of all those committed to your care, patterning your life in accordance with the teachings of Christ, so that you may be a wholesome example to your people?
I do.
Will you be loyal to the doctrine, discipline, and worship of Christ as this church has received them? And will you, in accordance with the canons of the church, obey your bishop and other ministers who may have authority over you and your work?
I will.
May the Lord, who has given you the will to do these things, give you the grace and power to perform them. Mark, I receive you as a presbyter of the church. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I think he'd done this before. Mark, receive this Bible as a sign of the authority given to you to preach the Word of God and to administer his holy sacraments. Do not forget the trust committed to you as a priest of the Church of God. Welcome our newest priest. My brothers, every Christian is called to follow Jesus Christ, serving God the Father through the power of the Holy Spirit. God now calls you to a special ministry of servanthood directly under your bishop. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are to serve all people, particularly the poor, the weak, the sick, and the lonely. As deacon in the church, you are to study the Holy Scriptures, to seek nourishment from them, and to model your life upon them. You are to make Christ and his redemptive love known by your word and example to those among whom you live and work and worship. You are to interpret to the church the needs, concerns, and hopes of the world. You are to assist the bishop and priests in public worship and in the ministration of God's word and sacraments. And you are to carry out other duties assigned to you from time to time. At all times, your life and teaching are to show Christ's people that in serving the helpless, they are serving Christ himself. My brothers, do you believe that you are truly called by God and his church to the life and work of a deacon?
I believe I am so called.
Do you now, in the presence of the church, commit yourselves to this trust and responsibility?
I do.
Will you be guided by the pastoral direction and leadership of your bishop?
I will.
Will you be faithful in prayer and in the reading and study of the Holy Scriptures?
I will.
Will you look for Christ in all others, being ready to help and serve those in need?
I will.
Will you do your best to pattern your lives and that of your households in accordance with the teachings of Christ so that you may be a wholesome example to your people?
I will.
Will you in all things seek not your glory but the glory of the Lord Christ?
I will.
May the Lord by his grace uphold you in the service he lays upon you.
Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, please stand.
Come, Holy Ghost, our souls inspire.
Enlighten and lift the lamps of fire.
Thou the anointing Spirit art.
Thus my sevenfold gifts impart.
Thy blessed unction from above
is
O God, most merciful Father, we praise you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, who took on himself the form of a servant and humbled himself, being obedient even to death on the cross. We praise you that you have highly exalted him and made him Lord of all, and that through him we know that whoever would be great must be servant of all. We praise you for the many ministries in your church and for calling these your servants to the order of deacons. Therefore, Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son, give your Holy Spirit to Jim. Fill him with grace and power, and make him a deacon in your church. Therefore, Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son, give your Holy Spirit to Brock. Fill him with grace and power, and make him a deacon in your church. Make them, O Lord, modest and humble, strong and constant, to observe the discipline of Christ. Let their lives and teaching so reflect your commandments that through them many may come to know you and love you. As your Son came not to be served, but to serve, may these deacons share in Christ's service and come to the unending glory of him who, with you and the Holy Spirit, lives and reigns one God forever and ever.
Amen.
You all did a great job. God's word and to assist in the ministration of his holy sacraments. Brock, receive this Bible as a sign of your authority to proclaim God's word and to assist in the ministration of his holy sacraments. In this Bible, our gift from God. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Share with one another a sign of peace. Before we move into our service of Holy Communion, I'm offering these fellows and that fellow a chance to introduce some of the special people who've come to be with them on this special day. Who's got the microphone? You're first. Mike.
If I start naming names, I'm going to forget someone. So I am grateful for the opportunity to appreciatively acknowledge the presence of friends and supporters today from the Bishop Kemper School for Ministry, St. Philip's Church in Joplin, Grace Episcopal Church in Carthage, and All Saints Church in Nevada. You all mean so much, and Anne, who really knows what this has been.
Anne's not done.
Similarly, I'd like to thank the Bishop Kemper School for Ministry and for the work that they did in our formation, which is incredibly important. St. Luke's South Hospital, Father Ron and Father Marshall, great experience there.
Good Shepherd Church, where I did my internship. Awesome people there, and I just loved it. So thank you very much for your time, the time I spent there. And then certainly St. Mary Magdalene Parish. I camped the whole row, several rows of us over there. And I love the church, and it got me started into this ministry. I have some special friends, Gary and Donna Douglas, who are with me, lifelong friends that I'm pleased to have with us as well today. So thank you very much.
This has really been a homecoming the last 5 years, so I'll try to keep this short. Those who, the Deacon Doreen from Christ Episcopal Church in Rye, who said, go be chaplain and gain hours from Phelps Hospital. And then Mother Carol, from Phelps Hospital, she said, oh, there's the St. Luke's, one of those East Coast people, the St. Luke's somewhere in Chicago or St. Louis or Kansas City. it's been the Spirit's leading for me to have been here, for me to have come here and to have served. So just for my fellow priests, for Bishop Keber, for the parishes I have supplied in over these years, especially among my presenters, Fred and Abigail Temple at Christ Episcopal in Lexington, and Marsha Scott, my supervisor at St. Luke's Hospital, and my father, Richard Jeske. Thank you all.
I want to say, Richard, we're especially glad you were here to be with Mark, your son. We know you also are, he's a Lutheran pastor from the Evangelical Lutheran Church of America. We are glad to have our brother and full communion partner represented by his presence today, too. Thank you very much for being with us. Let us with gladness present the offerings and oblations of our life and our labor to the Lord. Today's offering will be going to discretionary funds as well as to Episcopal Relief and Development for relief of the Hurricane Matthew disaster along the coast of our country and in Haiti and everywhere else in the Caribbean. So please give as generously as you can. Thank you.
Thank you.
things come of thee, O Lord,
and of thy own have we given thee.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Holy Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Everlasting God. Complete upon the cross the sacrifice of his life and to be glorified by you. On the night before he died for us, Jesus was at table with his friends. He took bread, gave thanks to you, broke it, and gave it to them and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine. Again he gave thanks to you, gave it to them, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Now gathered at your table, O God of all creation, and remembering Christ crucified and risen, who was and is to come, we offer to you our gifts of bread and wine, and ourselves a living sacrifice. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the body and blood of Christ. Breathe your Spirit over the whole earth, and make us your new creation, the body of Christ, given for the world you have made. In the fullness of time, bring us with all your saints from every tribe and language and people and nation to feast at the banquet prepared from the foundation of the world. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever.
Amen.
As our Savior Christ has taught us, we are now bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.